In the early 60s, there was not yet a standard model. Developments that Broughton, Englert, Giraldic, Hagen and Kibble and I were involved in 1964 were the beginning of what eventually became the standard model, because they led to a solution for one of the problems that had plagued the theory, namely the difficulties associated with the weak force, though none of us in 1964 actually saw that that was the way to go with the theory. The people who were involved in the work in 64 were a kind of minority in the theoretical particle physics community, in the sense that they still played around with quantum field theories despite its failures. And the inspiration for the work was, in fact, back in 1957, the Bardeen-Cooper-Schrieffer theory of superconductivity in metals and alloys. And the person who got the idea that the ideas which went into BCS theory of superconductors might also have a role in particle physics. Well, first of all, Yoichiro Nambu at the University of Chicago, and shortly afterwards, Jeffrey Goldstone of the University of Cambridge. Now, the ideas which were taken over from superconductivity theory were the concept associated with what's called spontaneous symmetry breaking, which is where you have a system in which the phenomena have less symmetry than the underlying dynamics. And the reason the phenomena have less symmetry, by phenomena I mean the behavioral particles in the theory, the reason is that the lowest energy state, which we call the vacuum, where there are no particles, breaks the symmetry. It's an asymmetric state with respect to some symmetry in the dynamics. That is a feature which is very important for superconductivity to work. And in superconductivity, it's associated with a phenomenon known as postcondensation, which is the condensation of a macroscopically large number of spinless particles into a single quantum state. And that postcondensate is what carries the current in a superconductor. Now, the phenomenon of postcondensation, which has more recently been exhibited in other systems as well, is intimately associated with spontaneous symmetry breaking in these systems. So what happened in 1960 was that Nambu and also Goldstone tried to see how this would work for particle physics in quantum field theory models. And they were thinking, as everybody, or nearly everybody at that time did think, in terms of broken flavor symmetries in strong interactions. So Nambu formulated models which were based on, in fact, massless protons and neutrons, which acquired mass as a consequence of spontaneous symmetry breaking. They were based on BCS theory, and a difficulty arose, which was that in the spectrum of the states, there were massless particles of spin zero, which became known as Goldstone bosons, because it was Goldstone who gave a simple interpretation of why it should happen. Goldstone's work was similar to Nambu's, but conceptually simpler, because whereas NAMBU stuck close to realistic superconductors in the sense that he started from fermionic quantities, spin half, Goldstone realized that the basic phenomena were the results of what could be very easily described in terms of bosonics, that is, spin zero fields. And the kind of models which Goldstone formulated were very close to what in superconductivity theory goes back to work of Ginsburg and Landau in 1950, where they pointed out that you could make a superconductor by forming a postcondensate of charged spin zero particles, but nobody knew where to get the charged spin zero particles. They in the end had to be composite objects in BCS. So in parallel, you had these two sort of frameworks for spontaneous symmetry breaking, NAMBU's program and the parallel ideas of Goldstone, and Goldstone's way of understanding why there should be the massless spin zero particles was the easier one to understand. It was conceptually simpler. And it was to do with the fact that if you write down a simple model as Goldstone did, you have in it a Mexican hat potential, as in that corner of the portrait. When you have that kind of potential involving fields, continuous quantities, rather than a marble or something rolling around a glass bowl, what happens is that you have some massive particles associated with the way where the thing goes up and down the slopes of the potential radially, but if you have something which is excited around the trough, that needs no energy, and the consequence of needing no energy is that the particles involved have no mass, and that's a necessary consequence of that way of spontaneously broken symmetry. So in 1964, some of us, at least, certainly Guralnik, Higgs, and Kibble and myself, were worrying about the Goldstone theorem and how to avoid having this phenomenon, because if you have massless particles in nature, massless spin zero particles, they get radiated very easily. Experimentalists can produce them very easily. There's no energy threshold, and they would have been known long ago, and there aren't any. That was the one motivation for the work of four of us. In Brussels, Engler and Braut were also inspired by the work of NAMBU and others. They were people who'd worked previously in condensed matter physics, so they had a sort of background in which spontaneous symmetry breaking is much better known than to particle physicists. And the earliest work in 1964 was actually the work of Braut and Engler in Brussels, though they didn't publish until some time later. And they wrote down simply some Feynman diagrams for a system in which spontaneous symmetry breaking occurred, inspired by NAMBU and Goldstone, and the the new element that they put in was that some of the fields were so-called gauge fields, like Maxwell fields, which hadn't been in the work of Nambu and Goldstone. And they discovered that just by doing a very simple Feynman diagram calculation, the spontaneous symmetry breaking generated mass for the quanta of the gauge field. In fact, the gauge field picked up an extra degree of freedom, which was the Goldstone degree of freedom, and turned what would otherwise have been photons of zero mass into spin one particles with mass and three different states of spin. A bit of history were told to me by Braut years ago was that he then phoned Abdus-Salam, who'd been one of the people who'd produced a mathematical proof of the Goldstone theorem along with Weinberg, and told him of their result and said, it's puzzling, we've got something which seems to contradict your theorem. He didn't get Salam on the phone and he didn't get a reply. But the two people in Brussels were worried they'd made a mistake. They were inexperienced in doing things in relativistic field theory. So the actual order of events was that in July 1964, I suddenly realized that the way out of the axioms of this theorem was to introduce a Maxwell type of theory, because a gauge theory has got some ambiguities where you have to fix the gauge to define the variables, and this destroyed the proof of the theorem. So I simply published a paper which said this is the way out of the Goldstone theorem, got it accepted by physics letters, and then I sat down and wrote down the simplest model in which was relativistic in which it would happen. And this was essentially a marriage of a model in Goldstone's paper with Maxwell. That's the equations up on the portrait there. And what surprised me was that that paper got rejected by physics letters. And it was as a consequence of that rejection that I added a couple of paragraphs, and I pointed out that there was an interesting feature of models of this type, which was that there would always be leftover massive spin zero particles, which now get called Higgs bosons. I also sent the paper across the Atlantic to Physical Review letters, where I thought they might have referees who understood what I was doing better. They did. The referee actually was Nambu, as I learned later. And it was Nambu who, in recommending approval of publication of my paper, who asked me to comment on the work of Ongler and Braut, which had been published on the day that my paper arrived in the Physical Review Letters office.